Hello students, good morning, happy new year to all of you. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to start with shares. So today you will have the 1st of January 2021 and we are going to cover the daily current affairs, the news, and I am referring basically the two national newspapers. The first is The Hindu and the second is Indian Express. Okay, you can refer any of these two newspapers or you can read both of them. Both are equally good and it will be helpful for your civil services examination preparation. All right, and it will be useful for the other governmental examinations also. All right, so let's begin with the current affairs for the 1st of January 2021. All right, so let's start with the news, which is the first news related to the laser dazzlers. All right. So what is this laser dazzlers? First of all, you must understand. So these laser dazzlers are nothing but a method by which you would send a warning signals, right? For example, if you are there in the sea, in the middle of the ocean, and you are basically, you know, cruising a ship, and you would suddenly found a suspicious boat, suspicious, you know, aircraft, suspicious the unmanned air vehicle, right? Or any sort of a pirates related activities in the sea. Okay. So what will you do? You will send a warning signal. Okay. So that is nothing but a warning signal that will be sent. Okay. From approaching you, right? So this warning signal, basically, if the other side of the vehicle or boat or aircraft, whatever it may be, if they don't change their approach, you're getting my point? If they don't change their approach, by this method, by this, you know, the laser dazzlers, what would you do? You would have a separate set of the sensors in this system itself, which would suppress, you know, the person's, the optical sensor. So that will suppress it, and that will basically, you know, either reorient the approaching vehicle towards you, or you know, it will confuse them so that it do not, you know, makes the cause or it do not cause a problem to you. So they are nothing but a non-lethal method for a warning signals for those vehicles which are approaching you or which are approaching certain sensitive sites, right? So that they can be distracted from their path. All right. So such laser dazzlers basically has to be made for the India security purpose. So the today's news is related to the Bharat Electronics Limited, which is a public sector undertaking company, which has basically signed a contract with the Indian Navy for initially supplying the 20 such, you know, the laser dazzlers. They are nothing but light amplification by stimulus emissions. So they are light amplification. You can basically amplify, and use those emissions of the radiation dazzlers. And that would be manufactured by the Bharat Electronics plant, which would be located at Pune. All right. So this would be, you know, manufactured for the Indian Navy for the security reasons. All right. And also the Ministry of Defense has also signed a contract with Bharat Electronics Limited for the procurement of a fire control system, which is also known as 10 Linux U2 fire control systems for those ships, which are basically frontline warships of the Indian Navy. So, right. So these are the two separate contracts which are signed by the Ministry of Defense. Okay. The first is basically signed by Indian Navy, and this Indian Navy would sign a contract through which, you know, the Bharat Electronics Limited would be making 20 such laser dazzlers. Okay. All right. So let's understand what is this laser dazzlers is all about. So first of all, as I told you, the laser dazzlers are nothing but a non-lethal method or for the warning. All right. Through for the warning or for the stopping of certain suspicious vehicle. That suspicious vehicle may be a boat, maybe aircraft, maybe a ship, maybe any sort of a, you know, the vehicle which are used by the pirates, right? So that the approaching vehicle can be stopped, right, at that warning point. And if the approaching vehicle do not stop, it will have the application of suppressing the person's sensor actions or the optical sensor actions with a disability glare in the case of non-compliance to the orders, right? So it will cause certain disability glare so that it cannot, it won't be able to see the target. All right. So what will happen? if such type of sensor cause a disability glare. So it will either distort, you know, the incoming UAV or incoming aircraft, or it will either confuse them, or it will blind a person temporarily, right? And so it cause the dazzles or distract the aircraft or UAV. So certainly it will cause certain destruction in the path of the incoming UAV or incoming ship, because it will have the mechanism of distorting, it will have the mechanism of the confusing or the blinding a person for the temporary period of the time, right? So this device, which is also known as the laser dazzlers, is a portable device, right? It can be operated right from the soldier. So you can put the device on a soldier, and you can use it for the military purpose also, for, you know, for adverse environmental conditions also. So it will have the multiple uses, right? It can be used for the military purpose, it can be used for the naval, you know, for the naval also, but for the security purpose, right? And this, the laser dazzlers technology, which is basically developed by DRDO, which is nothing but the Defense Research and Developmental Organization, which is a government of India, the premier research institution or research organization in the defense field. All right. And these laser dazzlers are basically produced indigenously. They are designed indigenously, and they are developed indigenously for the first time for the armed forces. And it will definitely support the Atmanirbhar Bharat, which would basically focusing on the production of indigenous technological advancement. All right. So this is basically the news which is flashing regarding this laser dazzlers. So what are these laser dazzlers? The Bharat Electronics Limited signed a contract with the Indian Navy, okay, for providing or for supplying these 20 laser dazzlers. What are these laser dazzlers? They are nothing but a warning signals. So they would provide certain set of a warning or the stopping signals to those suspicious vehicles. If that vehicle, which may be, you know, the boat, aircraft, or unmanned aerial vehicle, if those vehicles do not stop, right, from approaching, you know, your vehicle or your ship, then it would definitely suppress the person's or optical sensor's actions with certain set of disability glare. And that will basically either disorient the vehicle, or that may confuse the person temporarily, or that may blind a person temporarily, because it will cause, you know, some sort of a disability glare for a couple period of the time. And it will definitely distract the aircraft or unmanned aerial vehicle from approaching you. Right. So it is portable, and it can be used for the military purpose also. And it is designed and developed by Defense Research and Developmental Organizations. All right. Let's understand the second news. The second news is related to the Global Pravasi Rashtriya Portal. Okay. So this is the first time the Ministry of External Affairs is launching such portal. It is a portal as well as a mobile app. Because you must understand, millions of the Pravasis, right, which are also the non-resident Indians, overseas citizen of India, right? So these people are basically residing outside the country for various purposes, right? Now there are many such difficulties the government of India is facing for contacting those people, right? For example, during the normal time and during the emergency period also. Now there is a threefold, you know, the benefit of having this Global Pravasi Rashtriya Portal or mobile app, right? First major benefit is to connect the Indian diaspora, which is residing throughout the world. So it will be better connectivity between the Ministry of Defense and the Indian diaspora. Okay. And second, the diaspora can also, you know, can also contribute, right, to the development of our country through this portal, right? So it is nothing but it is a dynamic communication platform, right? It is a dynamic communication platform through which the Indian Pravasis are those people which are NRI, overseas citizen of India, which are residing outside the country, right, for various purposes, right? And it will be, you know, a dynamic communication platform between those Indian Pravasis, the Ministry of External Affairs, and the missions. Missions means those missions which are settled outside in the different countries, right? So it will be a communication platform between these three. And what will be the benefit? The benefit would be this communication platform would definitely help in engaging the Indian diaspora more intensively. The more intensively means, first of all, they can contribute to the development of this country by funding or by any other, developmental activities. right? And you will have also the mobile app, and that mobile app would be used by the diaspora and or Indian nationals, right? And there will be a web portal. That web portal will basically used by the missions, right, to connect with those diaspora which are residing outside. All right, so it will have the two-way interaction between the diaspora and the Ministry of External Affairs, right, with the help of the missions which are, you know, established outside. All right, and this initiative will definitely enable the three-way communication between the Ministry of External Affairs, our missions, and the diaspora. Okay, so as of now, as I told you, as of now, there is no effective communication channel, right, through which you can connect yourself with the Indian diaspora. But this is the first time the ministry has, you know, has made a tremendous effort to connect with the Indian diaspora worldwide, right? So it will definitely an effective communication channel with the Indian diaspora, and it will be helpful not only in the normal time, but also in the emergency situations. For example, now we are excavating, now we are basically, bringing those, you know, the Indian diaspora who are residing in the United Kingdom because of the COVID, you know, COVID-19, you know, the different strain has also come out, right? So for that thing, we are basically, you know, evacuating the Indian people from the UK. If we had those effective communication, it will be helpful, or it will be beneficial for the government of India to take the step much early. All right. So through that, the diaspora can contact with the government of India, and the government of India can also communicate with those diaspora which are residing in the countries outside the country, outside the India. All right. So this portal is increased, or this portal is created to enable the registration of Indian diaspora members, right? For example, registration means, for example, if you are NRI or non-resident Indians residing outside, if you are the person of Indian origin who are residing outside, and if you are having the overseas citizen of India card, okay? So those people who are either NRI or who are people of Indian origin, or the people who has the overseas citizenship of India card, right? So that will enable them to register, on this web portal. And it will not just going to facilitate the Indian government, right, to connect with the overseas Indian community, but also these overseas Indian community or Indian diaspora, right, for example, NRI, PIOs, you know, OCIs, they can also connect with the government of India through this web portal, and they can use the, the new and existing schemes, right, governmental schemes, which basically implemented by the government of India, right, for benefiting the Indian diaspora. So it's a two-way process, both of the government of India, or the India would benefit it from the NRIs, right? And NRIs and PIOs and OCIs will also benefit it out of the schemes which are implemented for their benefit, all right? And this portal and this app would definitely assist during any crisis management, and it will definitely lend helping hand to those NRI and PIOs who are residing outside the country. And it is a right portal which would enable the effective communication with the diaspora on the real time basis. On the real time basis, because you must understand, if at the time of need, if the need is do not reaches over there, it will be very difficult for the people to evacuate, right? And it will definitely, you know, have the ability to issue the emergency alerts and advisories, right? So if you have effective channel of communication, right, if you have effective medium through which you can be definitely send some sort of the emergency alerts or advisories, you can use this platform to disseminate those information to the Indian diaspora, and it will definitely enable the diaspora to reach the consular officers, because it's a three-way communication, right? Three-way communication means you will have the diaspora, right? You have the diaspora, that means the people of Indian origin which are residing outside the country, and you will have the Ministry of External Affairs, right? And also you will have the missions. So it's a three-way interaction. Right? So all of these, you know, all three are definitely connected. So people can definitely contact with the consular officers or during the emergency, and which will definitely facilitate those people who are residing outside. All right. Now, what is the significance of having this web portal, which is known as Global Pravasi Rishta Portal? So what is the significance of this Global Pravasi Rishta Portal? The significance is, as I told you, presently around 3.12 crore overseas Indians are residing outside. So that means you must understand there are 3.12 crore, the diaspora which are residing globally, right? And among these 3.12 crore, the 1.34 crore belongs to people of Indian origins or PIO, and 1.78 crores are nothing but NRIs. They are NRI. So it will be beneficial, right, for the government of India as well as for those people, right, to get benefited from each other, right? And this Global Pravasi Rashtriya Portal is a giant step. It's a giant step, right? And this would be, you know, help in the innovation and effective communication channel between the two. And this portal definitely, right, will not only send certain useful information for the diaspora, right? For example, the information which is related to the visa, the information which may be related to the passport and other consular services, right? But will also, you know, have certain set of other information which may be related to the missions, and would definitely send invite to the diaspora members for greater participation. So definitely it will help the diaspora, right, in the inter-multiple front. All right. So this dynamic nature of the portal and the app would also allow us to take the useful opinions of our diaspora. So it's an interaction platform, right? It's a channel of communication, right? You can invite those diaspora, you invite their participation. These diaspora would definitely come and, you know, take part of your, the discussions, right, through this platform, right, so that you can basically use that important information, right, for policy formulation or for conducting certain surveys also. All right, so it will be having the innovative and effective communication channel with the Indian diaspora, and that will definitely, you know, would provide a helpy hand to those diaspora who are residing outside the country. All right, so this is nothing but a platform which would definitely provide a channel of communication with the mission, with the Indian diaspora, with the Ministry of External Affairs. All right, now let's discuss the third news today, the fewer kids under three breastfeed. So first of all, you must understand the breastfeed is basically a practice, right, after getting birth, right, after taking the birth, the mothers used to breastfeed the newborn babies, right? So why this is compulsion or why this is needed, first of all, right, if you do not breastfeed your baby just after the birth, the immunity of that baby will not be developed, right? So for better development of the baby, the breastfeed is most important. We will learn more benefits, right, of the breastfeed, right, of, you know, to those kid who just born or newborn kids. Okay, we learn the benefits also. So what is the news which is flashing today is the survey which was conducted by the Ministry of Health under, you know, the National Family Health Survey, which released the data for the 17 states and 5 union territories regarding the breastfeed practices, right? That the number of women breastfeeding their newborn baby means the baby which is newly born, right, within an hour. That means the number of women which is breastfeeding those newborns just within an hour of their birth, right? So this survey says that the number of women who is breastfeeding their newborn babies within 1 hour declined in the last 5 years. That means this practice has declined in the last 5 years, right? So, but this survey also says that a significant changes in the last 5 years are also seen in the Meghalaya and the Lakshadweep, right? As well as the Sikkim, Dadra and Nagar Haveli, and Daman and Diu. So Meghalaya is a state, all right? Lakshadweep is a union territory, The Sikkim is a state. Dadra and Nagar Haveli are again union territory. Daman and Diu is also a union territory, and Assam is a state. So the significant changes has found in those states and the union territory. And the marked difference was observed with Dadra and Nagar Haveli, Daman and Diu, Manipur and Meghalaya. Let's see what are those, you know, differences that was found during this National Family Health Survey report. Okay, so let's understand the first where there is recorded a dip in the practices of the breastfeeding just within 1 hour of the birth. So the states where the practice of breastfeeding was declined within 1 hour of birth of baby or newborn kid. All right, so let's understand. So first of all, there is a difference between the urban woman and the rural woman. So first of all, the women who are residing in the urban areas, right, there in certain states and the union territories, there is a declining trend, right, for this practices, especially the Daman and Diu, Dadra and Nagar Haveli, right, along with Bihar, Gujarat, Sikkim, Telangana and the Tripura, right, this breastfeeding practices has declined in the last 5 years. Okay, and Dadra and Nagar Haveli and the Daman and Diu shows the least percentage of the children under 3 years who was breastfed within 1 hour of the birth. So these two union territories, the Dadra and Nagar Haveli and the Daman and Diu, have the least percentage of children which are breastfed, right, within 1 hour of their birth, and those children are lying 3 years, right? So these two union territory has the least percentage of the children. And these after Dadra and Nagar Haveli and Daman and Diu, this trend was followed by the Bihar, which is also have the least percentage of the children, right, who was breastfed within an hour of their birth, followed by Sikkim, followed by Tripura, followed by Telangana, followed by Gujarat. And you know, if you compare, you know, the Sikkim was followed by Dadra and Nagar Haveli, Daman and Diu and Assam in this context, right? And you must understand, for the Telangana, the percentage of the children, right, under three who was breastfed within their hour of their birth in the Telangana remains almost unchanged or remains constant. So this is, you know, the state-wise, the data where the practice of the breastfeeding was declined within 1 hour of their birth of the baby. Okay, let's understand the states where the recorded a high, right, breastfeeding practice, okay, just after birth, or you say within an hour of birth of newborn baby. All right, so it registered in the Meghalaya, followed by Lakshadweep, Kerala and the Mizoram, where there is highest percentage of the children, right, is breastfed by the mother just within hour of their birth. So Lakshadweep shows the sharp increase in the percentage of the children under 3 years and who were breastfed within hour of their birth. So Lakshadweep has so sharp increase, and only 10 states as well as the union territories. So these are the names of those states you can see, right? Out of 22 states which were there, only 10 states shows the increase in the percentage of the children that was breastfed within hour of their birth. So those 10 states and the union territories are Andaman and Nicobar Islands, Andhra Pradesh, Himachal Pradesh, Jammu and Kashmir, Lakshadweep, Meghalaya, Nagaland, right, Telangana and the West Bengal, right, shows that increase in the percentage of the children that were breastfed. All right. And let's understand the rural-urban divide. So rural-urban divide means what is the data which says that the rural woman, whether the rural woman had enabled their kid to breastfeed, right, within 1 hour of their birth, or the more urban woman followed this practice of breastfeeding their newborn kid within 1 hour of their birth. So let's understand this rural-urban divide. So in the 13 states and the union territories, the percentage of the children in the rural areas breastfeed within the hour of their birth was greater than urban areas. So you see here, in the rural areas, the percentage of the children which are breastfed within 1 hour of their birth was greater than in the urban areas. And now these are mostly seen in the Dadra and Nagar Haveli, Daman and Diu, Andaman and Nicobar Islands, Andhra Pradesh, Assam, Goa, Gujarat, Himachal Pradesh, Jammu and Kashmir, Maharashtra, Manipur, Meghalaya, Nagaland and Sikkim. And why this rural woman has more in terms of the breastfeeding, of their newborn kids within 1 hour of their birth? Because the rural women tend to stick with the traditions, right? There are traditions of breastfeeding their newborn babies, right? And the same is not the case of the urban woman, because urban woman is not sticking to the traditional, practices of breastfeeding their newborn babies. And that is the reason why the rural woman has, or why the percentage of the rural woman has higher in terms of breastfeeding their newborn babies within an hour of their birth. Okay, now let's understand the concerns related to it. The concern related to it is that the increased breastfeeding practices reduces the chances of the child being obese. So the obesity in the children is due to the least breastfeeding. If you have increased the breastfeeding practices, definitely the child being the obese would definitely reduces. And this practice is fading due to the increasing in the technologies, right? Now, because of advanced technology, these practices have now been declined, right? And moreover, if you do not breastfeed your children, it will also enhance the risk of illness in the infant from various infectious diseases, right? And 53% hospitalization occurred due to the diarrhea, right? If you do not, the heed here to these practices, and there will be 27% low respiratory tract infections, right? That can be reduced if the practice have been, enhanced, or if that the breastfeeding practices is enhanced, right? And not only the newborn babies, which is at the risk of being obese or being ill, but the mothers are also equally, at the risk of gaining weight, high blood pressure, suffer from, some sort of a postpartum depressions, right? And also the mothers are also at the risk of developing the cardiovascular diseases, the bone health. So it will have the more complications, not only on the newborn baby, but also on the mothers. And moreover, the oxygen saturation, body temperature were found to be lower in the infant, right? Infant fed through the bottles, right? So you must understand, and those infants which are breastfeed. So those infants which are breastfeed, the oxygen saturation would be much higher. The body temperature would also remains optimum. And if those children who do not breastfed, there will be long-term, risk like asthma, childhood cancers, and cognitive and brain, disparment also. So there will be a lot of complications if that practices is not, continued. And this will also have the impact on the health of mothers as well as the babies. So what is the bay ahead? The bay ahead is you can use some sort of a supplementary food or the liquids for the infants which are needed to be done away with. And there should be some sort of health centers or birth attendants, right, should be well equipped, right, to educate the new mothers, because here the many mothers do not understand the importance of this breastfeed. So if those birth attendants or the healthcare centers are well equipped of providing that insights to those mothers, it will be helpful to enhance this breastfeeding practices. And not only the mother, but also father should be actively participating and providing the aid to the mother so that the breastfeeding can be enhanced, or practice of breastfeeding can be enhanced, especially in the hospitals also. All right. Now, let's understand the conclusion. So overall, 16% of the neonatal deaths can be saved. So many neonatal deaths happened due to this illness. So 60% of such deaths can be saved if infants are breastfed from day one of their birth, and 22% of the breastfeeding starts within hour of their birth. So you can think at that if the 22% of those the neonatal who died, right, if they start breastfeeding within hour of their birth, 16% of such deaths can be saved. So can you imagine that 16% of the neonatals can be saved from the dying if they would have breastfeed early within hour of their birth? And researchers also shows that there are the significant nutritional benefit, significant psychological benefit, significant developmental benefit, significant immunological benefit, significant social and environmental benefits of breastfeeding on the mothers and their children. So it will have the multi-dimensional benefit to those mothers as well as the children if this practice is continued. And other important benefit, you can also check it out, that there will be a dip in the postpartum bleeding, and there would be more rapid uterine involution also, and it will also be helpful for those mothers to return to pre-pregnant weight early. And it will also delay in the resumption that cause increase in the child spacing. So that will be beneficial, right? So it will delay in those resumption of, conceiving the children, and it will definitely reduce the risk of the ovarian and the breast cancer. All right. So it will have manifold benefit of the breastfeeding of the neonatals, right, within an hour of their birth. All right. So let's begin to the new news, which is fiscal deficit. So what is the data? So this data was released by the Comptroller General of Accounts. Okay. So here the data says that the India's fiscal deficit has increased up to 135.1% of the budget target. Okay. So the fiscal deficit has increased, right, to that level, and which is nearly of 8 lakh crore for 2020 and 2028 in the last 8 months, right, if we start from April to the November 2020. So which shows that the fiscal deficit has increased, and this figure has stood, right, in the year earlier, that means in the last year 2019, this figure has stood just 114.8%, right, of the budget target. So you can think of the inflation or the fiscal deficit is much more this year, which is 135.1% in the last 8 months, right? When you compare this figure, right, which was 114.8% a year earlier, right? Regarding the other data which was released by the Comptroller General of the Accounts, is that the revenue deficit also crossed 125% in the first half of 2020. So revenue deficit also increased, the fiscal deficit increased, right? And the revenue deficit basically crossed 125%, right? And it has almost touched 140% of the budget target, so which is also in higher side. And if you compare the fiscal deficit reaches to 120%, which was a year's target, right? And which was also 9.53 lakh crore by the end of October, and which has further rose to 10.8 lakh crore in the month of November. Okay. All right. So we were studying basically the fiscal deficit. So what we studied is that the fiscal deficit for the data which was released for the India, which was increased to 135.1% of the budget target, right? which was nearly 8 lakh crore. And this was the data which was for the 8 months from April to the November, right? And when you compare this data, right, in the last year, 2019, it was found that the fiscal deficit was 114.8%. So if you compare this 114.8% to 135.1%, so this data has the tremendous difference. That means the fiscal deficit this year is much, much higher. And this data, which was released by Controller General of the Accounts, also released the data regarding revenue deficit. So revenue deficit, which has crossed to 125% in the first half of 2020, right? So which has touched almost 140% of the budget target. So which is also a higher side. And the data, which is also related to, you know, the fiscal deficit, which was a target, was 120%. Now, which has further increased to 9.53 lakh crore, and which has again rose to 10.8 lakh crore in the month of November. All right. And you must understand, because of COVID-19, which is basically a pandemic, the global economy is basically contracted. So global economy was contracting. Okay, now because of that, there is no demand in the international market. So if there's no demand, so what will happen is that you need to revive the economy. And in order to revive the economy, you need to spend the money so that it can boost the demand. Right? For that, you need to spend the money. But the report which was recently released says that only 62% of the budgeted expenditure for this year was spent by the November. So which is also to the lower side. Only 62.7% was spent, right? If you compare this data to the last year data, which was higher, which was 65.3% of the budgeted expenditure which was spent. So this year the budgeted expenditure was spent much lower. And if you're spending much low, how would you boost your, or how would you revive the economy? And the capital expenditure touched 58.5% of the target by November 2020, right? So this is also low in terms of the target completion, right? And if all such allocations which were mentioned in the Atmanirbhar program was executed, then the fiscal deficit would definitely increase to 9% of the GDP, okay, which is also higher. So you see, the fiscal deficit is on the higher side. And if you take the current scenario, the most important thing that you can be optimistic of bringing back the economy on the track and to bring back the confidence among the consumers, right? You need to spend the money, and that is basically need to fuel the economic recovery, right? And these are the definitions regarding the fiscal deficit and the revenue deficit that I kept at the last of this page. So you can read that out. The fiscal deficit means how much you have excess, you know, disburse the money from Consolidated Fund of India, right? So that is, you will be showing in terms of the fiscal deficit, okay? And that will exclude the repayment of the debt. For example, if you have certain amount of debt, right, with the government of India, the fiscal deficit do not involve the repayment of the debt, right? And you must understand, and all sort of over receipts to the fund, which are excluding the debts received during the financial year, also will not be considered. And this fiscal deficit is nothing but the shortfalls in the governmental income, right? When you compare with their spending. And what is the revenue deficit? The revenue deficit means you need to just consider the revenue expenditure and you need to consider the revenue receipt. So if you deduct the revenue expenditure minus revenue receipts, so you will get the revenue deficit. And this is how you will calculate the revenue deficit. All right. Let's understand the next news, which is anti-money laundering system. So what is this anti-money laundering system? So in the yesterday's news, I was covering about the Financial Action Task Force. Okay. So Financial Action Task Force is a watchdog regarding the global money laundering and global terror funding. So it's a watchdog for global money laundering and global terror funding. All right. So this Financial Action Task Force is expected to undertake the review for India's mechanism, right, to deal with the suspicious transactions and the financial crimes in 2021. So what is the process? Why it is reviewing the India's mechanism? Because it's a normal process. It's a normal process and it's an ongoing process that every year the Financial Action Task Force, which is a watchdog for global money laundering and the terror financing, would look into the different aspects of the country's preparedness regarding you know, controlling such suspicious transactions and the financial crimes. So it's a turn for the India in 2020 itself, but due to the global pandemic or global COVID-19 pandemic, right, this was postponed. Now this review would be conducted in the year of 2021, and this is nothing new. It is the recurring practice of, you know, the reviewing of the country's preparedness to deal with such suspicious transactions. And based on such review, this anti-money laundering, you know, the watchdog would definitely provide certain recommendations, and the country has to implement those recommendations. All right. So let's understand, you know, the anti-money laundering, you know, the watchdog. What is that? The Financial Action Task Force. So first of all, you must understand, right, there is a need for the financial institutions to raise the bar on the monitoring of such activities, because there are many such activities which are performed by the terror related organizations. For example, there are many NGOs which are working in the Pakistan, Turkey, which are basically having certain suspicious transactions, right? And they basically, you know, use that money, right, through this laundering or through this, you know, financial crimes for feeding this terror related activities. So there was greater need, right, to bar on the monitoring of such activities. And you must also understand, the Financial Action Task Force, which was deferred in India's evaluation, as I told you, which was supposed to be held in the year of 2020 due to the COVID-19. Now this review would be conducted in the year of 2021. And this would be the India's review or India's preparedness regarding the mechanisms to deal with certain set of suspicious transactions and the financial crimes, right? And which would be conducted in the year of 2021. And this is, as I said, this is an ongoing basis or process, right? Which would definitely, you know, would recommend certain measures and provide a detailed analysis of the each country's system to prevent these crimes, which are related to the money laundering, which are related to the financial crimes, so that the abuse of such financial systems can be stopped. All right. And what are the actions that they're taken? Okay, there are different type of actions taken by the FATF. So first of all, let's understand, FATF is an intergovernmental body, right? It was established in 1989 and its prime purpose was to stop the money laundering activities and the financial crimes, which basically use that money for funding of terror related activities. This FATF, which is an intergovernmental body, which was established in 1989 on the initiative of Group of Seven Countries, that is called G7. And the secretariat of the Financial Action Task Force is housed at OECD headquarters, which is located in Paris. And the FATF is policy-making body. It's a policy-making body. And its main purpose is to generate the necessary political will, because you must understand, the political will is very important to stop the money laundering activities, to stop the financial crimes, which will ultimately use that money for terror related activities. So this political will is most important, right? And this political will required certain set of the legislative reforms, regulatory reforms in the various countries based on the review conducted by the FATF every year. All right. And you must understand, in the year 2000-2001, right, the FATF expanded its mandate to incorporate effort to combat the terrorist financing in addition to the money laundering. So previously it was mandated to look into the problems called money laundering. Now it has also expanded its scope, right, to incorporate the issues related to the terrorist financing also, which will be using the money from the money laundering related process. All right. And you must also understand, in the year 2012, it has also added an effort to counter the financing of the proliferation of the weapons of the mass destructions. So how this money would be used for the proliferation of weapons of mass destructions. And you have seen the news that the Pakistan has already in the gray list. Okay, right now, because it has failed to act on the 6 key mandates, right, which are proposed and which are mandated to be implemented by every country. Now, since the Pakistan has failed to act on 6 key measures, right, the Pakistan have been kept, right, on its gray list by FATF. And further, the Financial Action Task Force had urged the Pakistan to complete an internationally agreed action plan by February 2021, right, to further blacklisting the Pakistan by the FATF. So every country is supposed to, you know, implement the internationally agreed action plan, right, with some mandate so that it can control the money laundering and other financial related activities for terror-related financing. And so far, only 2 countries have been blacklisted. One is Iran, and the second is North Korea. Only 2 countries have been blacklisted, and the Pakistan is at the verge of blacklisting if it do not comply with those norms, right, or those practices which are internationally agreed and which have also the internationally agreed action plan by February 2021. All right, so Pakistan may be blacklisted if it does not, you know, fulfill those mandate which was given by FATF in this regard. All right, so this is what is the news for the today. So thank you very much for attending this session. So we'll meet again tomorrow for the news for the 2nd January 2021. So I wish you all happy new year. Thank you very much.